Welcome, everybody. Today, as presented, we will talk about the V2X entity bootstrapping process. And this is the the important use case that we will speak about today to basically address market challenges, customers' problems, and how Scrypt is basically playing a key role in fulfilling that critical use case of the V2X ecosystem. So this is, if you folks can see me, this is me, who I am. Just at least to give some context to the slide deck, and we'll start the process and introduce Scrypt, introduce myself, Scrypt, and we deep dive into the entire slide deck. So this is who I am. I'm the lead product manager for V2X cybersecurity solution at Scrypt. You know, I'm really passionate about developing products that fix market and customers' problems. I like to live in the problem so we can, you know, produce something that is valuable and, you know, critical to success of our customers. I have a 15 years of experience, global, multifaceted project and product development solutions. We are located in Waterloo, Ontario, in Canada. It's south or east of Toronto. We are the mid and the hub of the automotive industry. So this is today's agenda. We'll talk about the company overview, V2X communication, think of some context and background about the V2X, and what is the Scrypt solution in terms of V2X. And we deep dive into the today's use case of the bootstrapping within the public key infrastructure ecosystem. So Scrypt is a global cybersecurity company focuses on automotive industry. We are owned by ETAS, and both entities, ETAS and Scrypt, owned by Bosch. So we are part of the Bosch family. And what we do here, we are a big believer of secure by design. And this is a very critical element of our mindset, our products, our solutions, and how we secure the design of our product, services, and solutions. And we enable security throughout different products, wide portfolio of solutions that we have within the automotive industry, as well as the other adjacent markets and services that are relevant to the automotive industry. We manage security through the solutions and the infrastructure that we introduce and develop to our clients. This is the holistic approach that, you know, differentiates our offering, our product and services to enable us, you know, basically address market problems and customers' pain point. We're the global cybersecurity for Bosch, as mentioned. We protect, secure all Bosch processes, products, operation technology, and infrastructure. We are the leading provider, as I mentioned, for cybersecurity. And, you know, we are also working with other companies globally and customers, and we serve. We have a global footprint, as you can see in the following slide. Our headquarters is out of Bochum in Germany. We have also offices in France, Sweden, UK, and Poland. We're also in Asia. We have an office in Shanghai, Japan, Korea, and India. We have a development team, sales team, and product team in Asia. Our office here today, you know, I'm speaking from Waterloo, Ontario, in North America, and we have another office in Michigan. We have a development team, consulting team, as well as a sales team, and we have a business development organization in out of California. So this is who we are and what we do in a very high level. We'll now jump into today's conversation and the V2X communication. And I call it a paradigm shift, and why it's a paradigm shift, and you'll see shortly. So this is a background of what is the V2X communication. V2X is a secure communication from a vehicle to the surrounding environment. And that surrounding environment could be another vehicle, could be an infrastructure. And also we talk about specific some use cases of pedestrian when the cell phone is allowed to communicate or is able to communicate with other vehicles or infrastructure. So so that it's the communication and uses the either Wi-Fi or the DSCRC, dedicated short range communication, or the CV2X or V2X to communicate, you know, from vehicle to other vehicle. This is the air interface technology. the most important thing of the V2X communication is to enhance safety. And that's the ultimate goal, right? We can see nowadays vehicles are equipped with all different kind of sensors. We have LiDAR, we have radar, we have cameras. All these are great and wonderful sensors, but they have limitations. When we talk about line of sights, when we talk about weather conditions, from a region to another region. But when we talk about non-line of sight communication, when the vehicle broadcasting safety messages, or receives and listens to other broadcasted messages, will be able to make an informed decisions and in a timely manner. For instance, if you're driving an intersection and you don't see somebody is driving over the speed limit, and that vehicle might run across the red line, red light signal. So without having the non-line of sight communication to provide this additional insight to you as a driver, you won't be able to stop, or the vehicle won't be able to stop. So that kind of some use cases will definitely be able to navigate through, be able to make an informed decisions on time and prevent accident and could be a fatal accident from happening. I always give an example to basically, explain what V2X to the audience. A few folks have watched the Game of Thrones. So this is the three-eyed raven. It's definitely it's that guy. So when you be able to see the future, you see the back and be able to understand what's going on. So that's how I can relay this into V2X. And, so the primary function is safety, as we talked, and a lot of research happened in Europe, in North America, shows solid results that it will reduce collisions by 80% from the driver advisories and warnings and safety messages when we talk about day one safety, day two, and so forth. The whole system designed with strict requirement for privacy and integrity, and that is very, very fundamental. You cannot have a viable and communication between vehicle without having integrity and producing a secure system to make sure it's not compromised. And that is a critical element of the entire system. The whole security solution, because we talk about security, of course, when you think about V2X, there's a hardware component to it, there is an infrastructure component to it, and there's a software from different layers. The focus in this topic today is the security, right? So when we look into the security, we see the solution is novel and complex for both European and North American standards. And globally, we have three different standards so far. We have the North American standard, we have the European standard, we have the China standard based out of CSSA. So we have the IEEE North American one, we have the ETC CITS, and we have the CSSA, China standard. So these are the safety different type of safety messages, the BSMs, basic safety messages, and the CAM messages in the European standard, sends location, speed, heading size, and the frequency of the cycle is 10 messages per second. All these messages, definitely they require security and privacy. Privacy, why? Because you don't want to trace and track vehicles, for the specific message that they sent out. So that's why the system was designed in a novel way, to make sure that vehicles are not tracked to the identity of the driver and so forth. So that's why security and privacy are baked into the design of the whole V2X ecosystem. So that was the high level of the V2X in general, which I'm sure majority of the audience is already aware of this, but just wanted to give some context into this one. Now we deep dive into what ESCOT solution, the integrated solution. What we call Cyker V2X. Cyker comes from cybersecurity. This is the word that ESCRIPT has for all the different products and services within ESCRIPT portfolio. The solutions comprises of the product lines, two product lines, as well as additional professional services that we offer, right? And I can explain why we offer these professional services. So we have the embedded Cyker V2X SDK software development kit. It's basically an embedded security software that is responsible for PKI management and the cryptographic functionality. And the cryptographic functionality is all part of the standard. You sign, verify, encrypt, decrypt all the V2X messages in a different global format, as I explained, and the SCMS, Security Credential Management System, the North American one, European, the Cooperative Intelligent Transportation System, and the CSSA is the China format. That's one product line that runs on the vehicle, runs on the roadside units. This is what we call the client side, right? The software, the embedded part. The embedded needs to communicate with the backend, you know, when download certificates, enroll the device, revoke the device, and so forth. The PKI, Cycle V2X PKI, PKI stands for Public Key Infrastructure. It's basically a credential authority comprises of backend software components that manage the credentials of the onboard units, roadside units, and enable trust and authenticity in the entire V2X system. OBU is the onboard unit that's, you know, you could have either like a form of ECU inside the car or aftermarket device that plugged into your vehicle. And roadside units is the it's basically an additional component that, you know, plugged into the traffic controller and traffic light to enable the communication with the surrounding environment using the V2X specific messages, and uses the same security ecosystem within V2X. We've realized over the years, you know, we work with different clients that, you know, how to onboard the clients to work on the specific pilot deployments and eventually move to production of V2X, because, you know, you do need to ramp up your customer and client and basically work with them to address certain challenges and basically try to disseminate the information and the knowledge that we have to work with our clients to make sure that they are successful on their journey of the V2X. And that's why the professional services related to consulting, related to certificate management, development, custom specific engineering requirements, specific use cases that the different market segments that we will talk about, whether infrastructure market segment, whether the automotive market segment, that need to enable the V2X solution. And that's why we offer the product lines in addition to the professional services. So this is, you can see here, it's a diagram that shows the end-to-end product solution. It starts from the PKI of the top of the screen. You see the Cycle V2X PKI, the trust anchor. This is basically, you provide your enrollment certificates, authorization tickets, you know, and basically it basically orchestrates the policy, right, from top all the way to the end entities, which is, you know, equivalent to the vehicle or the roadside units. And that's what we call them in the standard, what's called in the standard, the end entities. You can see here the embedded solution could run, same embedded solution with slight differences related to privacy, could run on the vehicle or the roadside unit to enable the communication. And also the vehicle will basically have this into the PKI backend and make sure that it's basically you have an end-to-end, you upload certificates, you know, top of certificates, you update certificates and you revoke certificates. This is kind of the entire system, how it works. And this is what S-Crypt is basically pioneering globally. Now we move into the other slides. So this is where we jump now into the bootstrapping process. And this is the topic of today's conversation, right? What is bootstrapping? What are the different use cases that S-Crypt is proposing? Actually, we are proposing this, but also we've deployed some of them. We have up and running clients that are using some of these use cases, and we will talk about why we are using this and what is the value we are adding to our client and what problem we are fixing. So in general, this is the Cycle V2X PKI. This is the European version. It's a very complex system. Sometimes I say this is a kind of dry material. I try to navigate through this and focus on the key points here. So you could see the diagram here, you know, you have the end entity at the bottom, you have the enrollment authority box, you have the application authorization box, you have the route management, and then the policy on top, right? So that's kind of, if you think about it, you try to visualize it, conceptualize this in a way that, you know, you have the client side, you have the enrollment side, you have the certificate management, you have the root CA, and then the policy that dictates how things will work within the entire system. Each one of those is a software component, certificate authority, and each one of them has its own function within the standard that that this should do, right? Whether you enroll a device, whether you revoke a device, whether you continue provide certificates related to authorization authority and so forth, right? What we need to focus today is on the enrollment side of things, which we call the bootstrapping. Bootstrapping is you register your device and you enroll your device and make sure that the device is authentic, is trustworthy, and it's allowed to communicate with the other vehicles and communicate and be part of the system. And that's what the, say stepping stone towards the large scale deployment. So you can see 0-1, this is kind of, you could say zero, could say, you know, prerequisite to what you need to do. Set up the PKI environment, including the offline root certificate authority, device configuration manager, and this is a very key topic for today's conversation, enrollment authority and authorization authority. This is what you need. You try to inject the trust anchor, try to integrate the TLM into the system, and make sure that your system is, you know, your root CA is, you know, known to the system and whitelisted, and you can use and be part of the whole solution. Because it's a key element of the wide-scale deployment is you need to have an interoperable system, meaning PKI provider A be able to communicate with PKI provider B. Not, I'm talking about vehicles, right? So if they have a services, if you have if like entities or providers supported by one PKI provider, right? Means these vehicles, in order to have a successful V2X deployment, you need to have communication across the board, meaning is, you know, you're allowed to communicate with the other vehicles that's supported by other PKI, right? Bootstrapping with registration enrollment. This is when you issue certificates for the end entity, subscriber, manufacturer, operator, device configuration manager, install the trust anchor, the TLM certificates, elector certs, and end entity, TLM in the European standard. And the electors now, it's in North American standard. That was kind of outlined in the IEEE 169.2.1 draft, or let's say released standard that was published in January 2021. How to register, how you issue enrollment certs, and this enrollment certs allows the end entity to communicate with the backend to download another set of certificates. And so that's the key thing. You need to have enrollment certs to enable you to download pseudonym cert, application certs, identity certs, or other certs. It depends on the use case and the region that you are in. The other use cases are pretty standard use cases, request of authorization ticket certificates, rekeying of enrollment certs, you know, change the key pair, the certificate itself, update and reset registration end entity, blacklisting of end entity, revocation and rekeying of RCA, EA, AA certificate. These are outlined in the standard, and these are the use cases where, you know, it's part of the normal operation of the PKI. The focus today is going to be on the 1-on-2, is the bootstrapping and registration process. So this is the, again, more a deep dive into the cooperative intelligent transportation system, credential management system, the EU architecture solution. You can see, you know, you have the distribution center within the local management, and you have the enrollment box, authorization box, and the certificate management box, right? What you can see here, the common between among different standards is the device configuration manager as part of the enrollment. And this is the component that is critical to, let's say, whoever is going to bootstrap an ECU or an RSU into your system. And that's very important. Also, you could see the different types of communications. You have a regular communication using the IP network. You have out-of-band communication. Also, you have an air-gapped communication related to the root CA, which is an offline component of the system, which is completely air-gapped, and it's not part of the regular communication, you know, for security reason. So this is the North American one. We try to simplify it. So when we look at the European design of the backend public key infrastructure security system and the North American backend security system, we took both and we tried to map them into an architecture diagram to simplify things and also to show the similarities and differences between the two different systems or two different designs, the different standards. So again, the DCM, device configuration manager, is a common thing. And you can see they also, North American one has the application authorization, which is in a different flavor of the authorization provisioning of certificates. It has registration authority to allow you to communicate and with the authorization to download certificates, which this does not exist in the European standard. We've added different boxes into this to accommodate the new standard that has been released in January of this year, the CRL signers. We've outlined the electors and, you know, the supplementary authorization server that was added into the authorization authority, right? They have the same style of communication. We have the air-gapped communication as an offline routes and regular communication, as well as the out-of-band communication. To move to the topic of the conversation, bootstrapping. What is bootstrapping and what are the challenges and what is the solution and what is the advantage of the solution? This is the introductory slide for the different use cases. We will talk about it today. Bootstrapping, as I explained earlier, it's a process to basically register and enroll your device into the V2X ecosystem. That's a simplified version of the bootstrapping. What is the challenge? The challenge, you could see here, like automotive OEMs might have already established PKI using X549. So now the question is, do OEMs need to set up a new PKI environment or repurpose or leverage what they have in place to basically enroll these devices or ECUs into their production line, right? And what is the implication? What is the benefit of doing this? Enrollment CA might handle multiple tenants, meaning you have multiple deployments. Let's say a city, let's say I live in Canada, I live in Ontario, in Waterloo. Let's say City of Toronto wants to deploy V2X system in multiple cities, right? Or province of Ontario, you know, if they have a system, that means they have to have, you know, multiple deployments in different cities, different municipalities, you know. How would you manage the tenancy, you know, one system with multiple deployments, or you have to have an instances of the PKI for each deployment? That's kind of challenges, you know, that, you know, impact the bootstrapping of these devices. And what is the requirement of the system? That's a given requirement that we have all to adhere to, which basically only trustworthy, certified, and conformance tested devices or entities must be enrolled. Enrollment CA certificate authority might handle different end entity types that should be distinguished in the enrollment process. What is the solution we are trying to offer and we're going to talk about is the proposes different bootstrapping processes depending on the end entity owner, whether it's a roadside unit provider or an OBU company or an OEM, automotive OEM and tier one suppliers, automotive tier one suppliers. DCM certs, it could be with X549 certificate format, because as you know, the V2X, as I explained earlier, the V2X uses the IEEE 1609.2 certificate format. It's unlike the standard X549 certificate format that we use on daily basis for our on internet surf or email browsing, sites browsing, and so forth, right? So that's kind of a different certificate format. The advantage of what we are trying to talk about today is proposed DCM certificate of type IEEE 1609.2 fits better than the X549 certs because of the ECA certificate is of a type 1609.2, and that is the standard because the enrollment certificates is based on the IEEE 1609. So having a harmonized solution between the DCM and the PKI helps to ensure you have a proper V2X permissions. And that V2X permission is key because you have a different end entities, you have different use cases, you have a preemption vehicles, you have a regular passenger vehicle, you have like you need to add these permissions at the beginning when you set up the entire system. So the bootstrapping requirement, as we talked, you know, only trustworthy devices and, you know, different types of end entities like private roadside units, public vehicles, and these are the things that we talked about it today. Problem statement. This is the, as explained, this is kind of more in depth. Do OEMs need to stand up a new PKI or leverage what they have? And this is a thing that we know, there might be other challenges that we are not aware of, but hopefully the solution is set up or designed in a way to accommodate all different challenges. The solution is we are proposing two use cases, two use cases, each one of them has, you know, two different variants, right? Meaning case one, automated or manual bootstrapping of end entity without using X549. Like, for example, if you're talking about like ITS operators, road infrastructure, they may not have a set up a PKI system in place. And what should they do then? Then that the process is to follow the IEEE 169.2. If the OEM or motor OEM comes in and they say, we have a setup in place, we need to use this, right, to harmonize what we have internally, that is also, there's a case two to help the mass production enrollment of these devices using the X549. What we are proposing is introducing a certificate related to the device configuration management or manager. That certificate is of IEEE 169.2 to authenticate the end entities in the bootstrapping process, right? And we'll talk about it more in depth in the following slides. So you could see here, today is the conversation about the enrollment. Again, I'm trying to come back into this often to make sure that we are on basically speaking of the same wavelength and focusing on the specific use case for today. You can see here we have case 1A, DCM register end entities, where you have canonical ID, canonical public key, and you need to enroll the V2X permissions within the install in the end entities. You have case 1B, again, this is without the X549, but you know, use the IEEE enrollment certs. Case 2A and B, use the existing X549. Case 2A, use X549 as certificate to enable the request of IEEE certificate. Case 2B, use X549 existing cert to replace IEEE cert for the enrollment, and then you will use the X549 to communicate with the authorization authority to download the authorization tickets and so forth. Enrollment in general, as a hint to everybody here, helps the responsible for enrolling in new vehicles, device in the system, replace real world identity with an in-network identity, right? And this is what we talk about using X549 versus IEEE 169.2. May include proofs of certificate of compliance, essentially give device an entry ticket to participate into the ecosystem that you're allowed to communicate with. So we'll start with these different use cases, but before we jump into these different use cases, I want to set the tone here on the prerequisites and the initial steps that are important and I would say mandatory to enroll your device. So here you can see on the right side, you know, you have five steps. We highlight them in green because you will see them in green in the following slides, because, you know, we're not going to repeat them, but they are there, right? They're there because you need to do them and to complete the entire bootstrapping process. So, task one, or, you know, case one is, you know, you start with the DCM request and manufacturing certificate of type IEEE 169.2 from the enrollment CA containing V2X permissions. You know, this is very important when you talk about permissions, as I alluded previously, you know, to, you know, classify your end entity and say what features are, sorry, what use cases are being used and what is the purpose of this one. And that is very important. Initial trust anchor gets installed in the end entity, like such as, you know, TLM certificate or Elector certificate. TLM is in the European standard, Elector certificates in the North American standard. A URL of a global distribution center, and, you know, as well as certificate ID of home root CA. Because you can see here we have two distribution centers. We have the global distribution center, similar to CPOC in European standard, and we have a local distribution center within your deployment. And entity gets 3 and 4 gets or downloads the global certificate trust list. and this is different than 4, because 4 you will get or download the local CTL from the local home DC. And these are kind of the two different cases that, you know, we have into the system. Number 5 is finally you get the device gets or downloads the relevant certificate revocation list CRL from the local home DC and other foreign DCs within the deployment. So you set up this at the beginning, These are the five steps that are used moving forward with every single use case that we will tackle. Now we start with case 1A. This is the registration of canonical public key at enrollment CA. So this will start from 6 all the way to 10 because we talked about 1 to 5 on the previous deck, the previous slide. So 6 is the end entity device will create a canonical key pair inside the HSM, inside the some OEMs, they call them, you know, the cryptomatic box or V2X ECU, right? And now we can see a trend of, you know, having a V2X ECU included in the telematic box to the different functionalities of this one, right? And that's where you need to create your canonical key pair. And then the end entity sends the canonical public key to the DCM, device configuration manager, which is again as a component within the manufacturing plant of the OEM or the tier one supplier, right? Or could be the RSU manufacturing company. It creates a unique canonical ID. So the DCM creates a unique canonical ID that's not the same as a public key for you know, the audience trying to introduce themselves first time for this, and selects the V2X permission to set in the end entity type. And then the DCM signs the end entity registration request containing the canonical ID, canonical public key, and the V2X permission, and sends it to the ECA. So now the ECA knows that specific registration information from that specific end entity because, in, you know, canonical key pair were created, was sent out the public key out of the number 6 use case, sends out this one into the DCM. DCM create the unique canonical ID, get the permission set, sign the information and send it to the ECA. Now the end entity creates an enrollment key pair. That's another task, right? That the another step, another use case that will take place. Enrollment key pair inside the security HSM, and then the end entity request IEEE or ETSI enrollment certificate type from the enrollment CA. So now the device has the enrollment certs following these different 10 steps. We talked about the first 5 steps, and now this is case 1A without using X549. Again, this is a new setup, a new PKI infrastructure to allow specific, operator or the device manufacturer or the system integrator or the OEM to add this into the V2X ecosystem. So this is case 1A. Now we jump into another model, I would say, another model of implementation, which is case 1B. You authenticate and you authorize initially the IEEE initial IEEE and ETSI enrollment certs. Again, 1 to 5 are all the same, right? And then you have from 6 to 10, these are the S-script, proposal or S-script implementation so far. So the end entity in this case creates an enrollment key pair. It's unlike the previous slide, a previous case, 1A, when the end entity creates canonical key pair. Here is a creating enrollment key pair inside the HSM, right? And then creates an enrollment certificate signing request, CSSR containing canonical ID and the end entity's V2X permissions, and send this, to the DCM. DCM checks validity of the V2X permission and canonical ID in the enrollment CSSR and signs this enrollment CR and sends it to the ECA. So now the ECA knows about this end entity. And then enrollment CA issues enrollment certificate and provides it to the DCM, which forwards it to the end entity, or the end entity downloads the enrollment certs from the enrollment CA at a later point in time. Depends on how the implementation takes place. So this is kind of the different cases without using X549, case 1A, case 1B, and now we move ahead to case 2A. This is an authentication authorization of the entire system. Sorry, not the entire, for the end entities using the X549, which is as available certs within the mainly the either ITS operator or the automotive OEM. Again, 1 to 5 steps are pretty common and they're across the board for different cases. We're not going to talk about them, but we keep talking about the blue lines or the blue circle from 6 all the way to 10. Then entity provides its existing XY49 certs to DCM. So you assume that the device already has XY49 certs. That may not, right? Depends on the specific deployment and, you know, the requirement from the OEM or the ITS operator. And the DCM adds the XY49 certs together with the end entity permission to registration request, signs this, and send it to the enrollment certs. So here you're leveraging the existing XY49 certs from the end entity, give it to the DCM. DCM adds the permission, and then sign and send it to the enrollment CA. Now the end entity, the device that has the, this is the module or the V2X module, has the HSM, hardware security module, creates the enrollment key pair inside the HSM, and then creates an enrollment request, signs it with the private key associated with the registered XY49, because the XY49 has the set that is already available to you, and sends it to the enrollment CA. Enrollment CA issues enrollment certificate and provides it to the end entity. And then now the end entity has the enrollment certs to enable the end entity to use the, be able to communicate to the enrollment and download, authorization to download additional certificates such as pseudonym or the application authorization, depends on the use case, right? That means you're using the XY49 to establish the communication first, and then you download the IEEE-alike IEEE 169.2 format as enrollment certs to allow you to communicate with the backend system. That's case 2A. Now, if we move to case 2B, you know, you use the XY49 available certs completely to replace the IEEE 169.2 cert, right? And where you provide this to DCM, device configuration manager adds the XY49 certs together with the end entity V2X permissions to registration request, signs it, and send it to the enrollment CA. Enrollment CA stores the XY49 certs on its whitelist, and then, you know, you'll be done with it and you'll be able to communicate to the backend, because this XY49, it's already registered, it's associated with your device, and it enables you to communicate with the backend system. Of course, different, I would say, different clients or customers have different perspectives and different requirement and implementation. There is no one size fits all, but, you know, that's kind of in general what we're trying to accomplish. We're trying to be flexible here, diversifying your bootstrapping process in a way not to add complexity, but actually to address different concerns, different requirements, and different jurisdictions, right? Because at the end of the day, you have to comply with the policy, and you have to go with what it's being assigned in your certificate statement, certificate policy, and, you know, how would you make sure that your entire process is secure, it's authenticated, it's completely done in an integral way. And that's where we're trying to add flexibility and work with different OEMs and different ITS operators globally, not just in one region, but globally, to adapt what they have and also suggest and recommend a solution that, you know, fulfills their requirement. So that concludes all these different use cases we hear. The key takeaway, this is very important for us, you know, to talk about what is the conclusion with these four complex. I know this is a very dry material. I know different vendors, probably different PKI providers or different OEMs might have a different perspective on this, different opinion, and that's totally fine. You know, when we thought about designing such system, we thought of security at the beginning, you know, security by design, security in terms of management and, you know, enablement. And that's what we have accomplished so far. And we have some clients that use these different types of enrollments. So we've proven in the field that these, they do work. Introducing DCM, certificate type alike 169.2 ensures all V2X permissions are considered. And that is, again, very critical topic. A, it's, we are following the standard. B, harmonizing the DCM certificate with the entire certificate of the system, and ensuring the right permission with the right requirements set right from the beginning using this specific certificate format the IEEE certificate format within the DCM. Reduce costs by focusing on strict requirement. Do not consider different entity types and multi-tenancy if not required. You know, you can just focus on what you need to do. You don't have, for instance, if you're an ITS operator, for example, and you have a specific use case, you don't need to get a solution to enroll, you know, specific devices, but that solution was given to you, provided to you, that it's basically also helps other use cases. You know, you don't have to pay for things that you don't use, right, basically, or you don't have in your solution. ESCAP provides high end-to-end security solution for all variants, and this is definitely proven, and this is aligned with the standard. And we implemented different variants and tested them with multiple stakeholders in the scope of pilot deployments since 2019. So this is proven already. It's been 2 years or 2.5 used in different jurisdictions. So that's kind of conclude the entire different use cases of the bootstrapping of entities. And I think, you know, I would say thanks, everybody.